was fair and overall intro, because the breadth of what we're going to cover in the interview will do my job for me, but it's an honour to be sitting next to you, Mary Anne Hobbs.
Oh, you're sweet. Thank you so much. It's an honour to be here. I love Boiler Room.
Oh, that's a great start.
We've got a very kind of extensive and passionate history, myself and Boiler Room, as you probably know, so yeah, it's lovely to be here.
Yeah, 5 or 6 years from when you first took the early incarnation to Polish Festival.
Absolutely, yeah.
It cycles all the way back around. It's quite nice.
And they were pretty much broadcasting on iPhones back in those days, I believe, so yeah.
We haven't come that far yet, like, we're still pretty basic. Yeah, it's hard to really know where to start, because what we're going to cover is drawing ley lines between multiple different scenes and sounds. But for most people, DMZ makes the perfect intro in terms of where they may have had an introduction to you and your work on radio and your commitment to that scene. So do you want to start off there?
Yeah, why not? Yeah. It was DJ Pinch, really, probably, that was the original seed for me. Obviously, you probably know him, just a phenomenal artist from Bristol. And I remember hearing a tune that he had made called War Dub with Dutty, which I believe was the first ever Tectonic release. And it was just one of those tunes that completely stopped me in my tracks. And I remember being on the top of a double-decker bus, actually, going through King's Cross in the driving rain, on the telephone to Pinch, talking to him about this music, this scene. And he basically said to me, you need to find a guy called Mala and go to DMZ, because if you're interested in this music, there you'll find the home for it, there you'll find the hub. And so I did.
But what year must have that been, like 2005?
That was 2005, yeah. So it's going back a little while now. But those were extraordinary times, the early days at DMZ, and at Forward too, it's got to be said. I mean, you know, they completely changed my life. And I remember, you know, kind of going to those dances and feeling that it was a really big night if there were 10 people in the room, all of whom were probably other producers, people making that sound as well. I mean, the scene was tiny at that point.
Yeah.
But I had a really instinctive, passionate belief in what those producers were doing, which I suppose resonated 6 months later in Dubstep Wars, which was the programme that we did on BBC Radio 1. And it was really nice to get the nod from Rolling Stone, actually, just very recently.
So was it top 25 internet mixers of all time or something? It's a bit of a loose category, but quite honestly, the first one on there, it's pretty cool.
Yeah. That was just an extraordinary time in my life. And
I mean, even now you're kind of trying to suppress your sheer joy talking about it. And it's interesting, we'll get on later to your early kind of formative experiences in music, and that was also quite literally a runaway passion at times. But the fact that you're in a position where you could help facilitate and progress the culture that you were so immediately enamoured with must have been quite a fortunate thing. Like, you had a stable position which you could take something that immediately clicked with you and basically push the entire scene to an international level and continue even now to further on. That must have been pretty nice to be at the heart of it, like, I can do something for you guys and elevate it.
Yeah, very much so. And I think my response to dubstep in, well, certainly that generation of dubstep artists, the DMZ generation, was very similar to John Peel's response to punk. When I used to listen to John when I was a little kid, I remember the entire fabric of his programme changing almost overnight with the advent of punk and his first experiences of punk. And, you know, he went from playing probably really extensive 25-minute gothic psychedelic guitar solos, yeah, to 3-minute punk tunes overnight. And I think if you were to look at the shape in which the Radio 1 programme changed at that point, it would be very similar. Dubstep absolutely captivated me, and I was in a position where I had this phenomenal global audience who trusted me implicitly, really, I suppose. And I was able to bring this new sound to them and see that incredible passion that I had for this sound mirrored back to me, which was, yeah, it was exciting times, really good, yeah.
Should we play one of those early tracks?
Yeah, sure.
Would you like to play Pinch?
Yeah, let's play Pinch.
Yeah, just
hold on a sec, what have we got here?
Yeah, it's all loaded up.
Yeah, this is incredible. This tune is called Koali, which is still one of my great favourites of Pinch's. And I think exemplifies the great depth and the richness of textures and the elegant nature of his production. It's just beautiful.
Yeah, elegant's the word that a lot of people who maybe weren't part of that first generation may not affiliate with dubstep now, though it is kind of slowly coming back round. But there was a very fragile elegance to a lot of the early productions, perhaps because the producers are in completely unmarked terrain. There's nothing really to go against in terms of context. They weren't having to, as far as I can tell, fight to get their voices heard in comparison to many other dubstep tracks. They could basically just channel their proclivities they wanted, and you end up with extremely alien, beautiful music that then maybe became a little bit more generic over time. But yeah, some of those early productions are just like still pretty mind-bending.
It's interesting because that was part of the way in which dubstep was curated. And I think it was very much a key element within the scene that actually, if you wanted real status as a producer, you had to come with a sound that was very, very unique. This is Pinch's calling card, I guess. This is his ace, you know, still this tune, I absolutely love it to this day. And I don't know, it just has this beautiful sense of space within it as well. Space is a really important element to me. It always was within dubstep and within all forms of different music. And it's kind of interesting, I was having a conversation the other day actually with another one of the presenters at Six Music, who said to me, "I don't understand your love of instrumental music. Where does that come from? How is emotion of any kind able to be transmitted without words?" And I said to him, "Well, I feel that once you've exhausted all words in any language, instrumental music will take you to a completely deeper place, you know." And I think the space within the sound is a place in which you can find peace. And as all of us now live in this kind of crazy accelerated culture as we do in the West, those moments of peace are really special and they're quite hard to find. But within a production like the one that you're listening to now, Qawwali by Pinch, you do find this beautiful sense of peace within those bars, and that's it's really important to me, you know. I love it.
Yeah, I mean, we'll get on to the application of space in some of the more classical and out there experimental music that you are a keen supporter of. It kind of leads nicely onto the story that you're going to tell about Sunn O in 2007, rather, and also the way that Code 9 worked with Space 8.
To use one word, it was about texture.
Sure.
And that beautiful combination of two different sets of textures, Code 9's beats and Space 8's voice. And I think that was a really, really important element of what he did. But yeah, 2007 Sunn O, you want to talk about?
Yeah,
wow, that was wild. That was absolutely incredible. Where do you even start speaking about something like this? It's crazy, but
I suppose what might be good is to contextualise what it looked like. For those that don't know, Sunn O is in the middle of Barcelona in like this urban environment, I think.
Yeah,
right?
It's vast. It's this beautiful space on the outskirts of the city, and it looks kind of like giant aircraft hangars. It's all concrete and steel. And I remember standing there with Scream, who was the headliner in 2007, looking out across this vast open space in soundcheck. And Scream just looking at me saying, "Look, this is the kind of stage that Faithless would play. Are you certain about this?" You know, and I said to him, "Look, I've spent 6 months laying the turf. Let's just see what happens. You know, I'm really confident that people will come." But yeah, I took RSJ, obviously core originator of the sound, Code 9 and the Space Ape. Mala was there, although tragically he couldn't play because he'd already played at Primavera, so there was a kind of...
It's a bit of booking beef.
Yeah, exactly. Booking beef is the right expression. Scream and I played, but I remember that night. I opened the stage at midnight and I'd only played a couple of tunes. We were maybe, I don't know, 7, 8, 9, 10 minutes into the set, and just rivers of bodies started flooding into this arena. It was unlike anything that we'd ever seen before, and Code 9 ran up to me, shook me by the shoulders and said, "Oh my God, they're coming, you know. And by the end of the night, there was 8,500 people just the wildest crowd that I think I've ever seen in a lifetime. Watching Scream play for the very first time, headline for the very first time on an international stage. And that was 10 times the audience that Dubstep had ever experienced at that point. I suppose the biggest gig would have been DMZ's first birthday party, which was the historic night where obviously the club needed to be moved out of third base and up to Mass in Brixton because there were so many people locked out. It was mobbed outside. And Mala stopped the dance and said, we're going to have to move it upstairs, you know, we need to let some more people in, you know. So we were looking at an audience, probably 10 times that size. And I remember the following morning, every paper right across Europe had that headline, Dubstep takes Sonar, and it was just wild. I went to talk to Scream, and he said to me, God, he said, I felt like a king up there, you know. It was the greatest night of my life on earth. And he was 21 at that point, you know. It was
the next
wild.
Track on your playlist is actually the one that you ended your radio show, your Radio 1 show with, rather. Which I think makes sense, because the rapid acceleration of what you're talking about, it strikes me even now that it jumped very quickly from 80 to 800 to 8,000 on an international level.
Mm.
3 years kind of elapsed and dubstep crystallised in people's minds as a valid kind of form of music and began really taking over in the UK. But it felt like you've been cut slightly short to be moved from Radio 1 right when things were still in full flow. And this, what you did end up playing, felt like quite a cheeky riposte. I mean, you can still hear now in the recording, even now, a smirk breaking out over your face as you kind of spring on your producer. So why this? And also, did it feel a bit like you had been cut short at that point?
Not at all. I resigned from Radio 1. So it was me who made the decision. And I always feel that, I don't know, if you look historically across my entire career path, I've always resigned when I feel that things are absolutely peaking, because then I think you pick up the flight and you pick up the traction that you need to move to the next place. So I felt that in the slot that I had at Radio 1, I'd achieved absolutely everything that I could conceivably do with that time slot in that form. And so I decided that I wanted to move on and do something else. And it was at John Peel's funeral, actually, that I had just a moment thinking about Peel's influence in my life and how important I suppose he had been as a mentor in an unofficial capacity, obviously, but just my contact with him over 10 years, watching the way that he worked, the way that he researched, how he played out his value systems within the framework of his programs. I always felt like it was a kind of quite an important thing to do at some point, to put something back and to do that one-on-one and to do it physically and in real terms and not just pay lip service to it. So an opportunity came up to mentor people at Sheffield University. So I went to Sheffield University for a year and did that. I worked in the media department and looked after 700 crazy kids who I loved. And it was very much my decision to do it. It felt like a very, very good time to step away from Radio 1 when everything's peaking. That's always a good time to leave, you know, rather than when you're on the downslope and they're ready to boot you off the edge of a cliff, you know. So it was absolutely my decision. But yeah, I put the final program together with great care, and I had played a tune by Clara Intellecto called Beautiful Death that everybody assumed would be, you know, the final tearful closing salvo, you know, the swan song. But then I just kicked that off for a second and had to come back with Oris.
I mean, honestly, I've got to say, dig out this recording, it's so funny to hear you like just smirk and articulate, being like, guys, if you don't like it, it's going to have a lot of swearing, just switch off, step back, and the minute later come in, be like, I had to do it, didn't I? It's so cheeky. It really works, yeah. I felt that like the just switch off line was quite fitting as well, your final word. Well, not quite, but close to it, yeah.
I think as well, I mean, this is one of the hottest dub plates of all time that's never actually had an official release, and I've always loved it. And I think it kind of captures a lot of the fire and the energy and the passion of that moment in which kind of, I suppose, those textures crossed over and became the foundations of what it was that I fell in love with. So, yeah, it was absolutely the right tune to close with.
Yeah. You mentioned fire, especially in Miss Dunamore's voice, and the person that we're going to play next both combines ridiculous bite and an incredible willpower, but also, before we started rolling, someone that you said you adore, and I felt quite like a cutesy motherly instinct coming over. And I'd love for you to really articulate how it was like meeting Kendrick Lamar and how the interview came about, and I guess just spiel about your thoughts on the man.
Yeah, I do adore him, I really do. I think he's probably the single most important artist of any genre in America right now. And yeah, I waited 2 years for that interview. And even on the train down to London from Manchester, I still wasn't entirely certain. It was kind of touch and go whether or not it would really happen. And my producer, Jack, was sitting next to me thinking, you know, sort of wringing his hands, thinking, he's going to me, God, is it going to, do you think it's really going to go down? And I was like, I don't know, let's just show up and see what happens. But yeah, he was unbelievably gracious and everything and so much more that you would wish an artist of that stature to be. And I don't know, there was a lot that really resonated with me in the conversation that we had, but I thought he said a couple of things that really stuck with me. He said that as a creative artist, he's always trying to find that kind of childlike state that he remembers being 6 or 7 years old when he was doing backflips off a bed. And he said, you know, you were fearless at that age and you weren't afraid to hurt yourself, you know, you just wanted to do the backflip. And he said as an artist he's always seeking that state. And he said to me that he was not afraid to fail, and he wasn't afraid to fall and fall and fall and fall again. And he thought that that was one of the primary reasons that he'd become so successful, because he has no fear of failure really particularly. But yeah, he has a kind of magic as a human being, there's no two ways about it. And I think the way in which he fuses such a powerful political dialogue with his own personal story, and also within that is really happy to articulate his own fallibility as well. I think that's quite extraordinary in any artist. But yeah, he was something else. It's really interesting. I got a wonderful letter in the aftermath from a teacher called Helen Wilson, who teaches an acting class in London. And she had said that the entire class had listened to the interview, and the element about fear really resonated with them as well, and this idea that actually you shouldn't be afraid to fail, you have to fail to really make any progress in life. And she said that they'd had this really emotive session, and in the aftermath she had seen her young class, her actors, moving in completely new ways, and it inspired them so much, you know. So I sent it on to Kendrick, this letter. It was, I don't know, it's just a wonderful thing to see that, you know, to see those words resonate on a bigger scale, on a larger scale out in the world, where the listeners, you know, sort of inhabit these really creative spaces themselves. It's always wonderful to see that kind of stuff.
Yeah, that's always quite nice, because it encapsulates what I feel is pretty important about Kendrick, in that you can be an artist who is a figurehead of a generation because of a certain cultural reason, but the fact that his message has not only resonated but dovetailed with a very important time in American politics. And we could be here all day talking about racial injustice and the effect that he feeds into that. But when you see people chanting "All Right" on the street,
it's powerful.
Says it all really. It is extraordinarily powerful, and he's bringing so many people with him, fusing, you know, hot funk and incredibly hard street dialogue with a real uplifting, powerful message. Doing it, fusing many musical styles that may be off-putting individually to your average consumer in America or across the world, synergizing it, packaging it, and getting everyone on the side. Yeah, I mean, there's a reason you have these once-in-a-generation artists.
It's amazing though, isn't it, to see that album drop straight out of the sky and straight into number one in the UK without any promotion, without any live appearances, without anything at all, just pure love for that artist. And yeah, I don't know, it blew my mind, and I was elated to see that. I just thought, yeah, the British fans are just, you know, they're down, just like the Americans are, you know. And I don't know, he said something that really resonated with me very deeply as well, and I said it back to him. something that you said recently in an interview that I just picked up on. He used the expression loyal to the soil. Love that. Absolutely love it. And I thought, I need to ask him about that. And he said, that means in every way. He said, it means I'm loyal to my family. I'm loyal in my relationships. I'm loyal to my music. I'm loyal to the people that I love. I'm loyal to my community. I'm loyal to the streets of Compton. I'm loyal to my people. And I think as well, that's a really powerful message to push out there, you know, and he's changing things. That's a really simple message, but it's a message that changes the dynamic of the environment, I think, you know.
Yeah, absolutely, and the human element in his music, he has a track expressing unbelievable vulnerability, saying that he beats himself up for FaceTiming a dying friend in the hospital. That is the moment that he, I guess, got detached from that loyalty, and it eats away at him. It shows an incredible personal element that pushed it all the further, I guess.
I also had a really interesting conversation with him about Coltrane, and I'm reading a great book about Coltrane at the moment, actually, and there's a passage about his progression as a young artist, and there's this amazing piece that a guy who was playing with him at the time said he used to practice scales all day and all night until his reeds were red with blood. And at that point, when he couldn't play any longer, he would go to the library and he would study the texts of classical music because he wanted to understand how this music moves so that he could break it down and restructure it himself. And I see a lot of parallels between the work of Coltrane and the work of Kendrick in terms of his commitment to his art, but also in terms of the way that he creates these mind-blowing technical arrangements as well,
sure.
You know, that are so exquisite and beautiful and feel effortless, and yet you know are completely redrawing every single rule, you know. So, I don't know, he's wild, he's a once-in-a-generation artist, isn't he?
Yeah, I think that's probably the best way to sum it up.
Yeah.
And he's got Thundercat on the album. We have
and Kamasi Washington too.
Yeah, which we can get onto, but we've got a photo of, I think, I can't remember exactly where, but Thundercat playing an old boiler room. Probably from around the era that you were taking us to Poland.
Yeah.
It's pretty nice. Yeah, it's cool to see Thundercat especially getting his dues. One thing we're not going to probably have time for is do the astral planes, but the fact that that brain feeder, low in theory world, can get sucked up and obviously have, not a second wind, but an additional national exposure from Kendrick. It's pretty cool as well.
Yeah, it really is. Yeah, I've got a lot of love for that world. Low End Theory is probably my favourite club to play in the whole of America, which is brilliant. That's kind of the hub. I suppose it's a bit like DMZ was for dubstep. Mm-hmm. For that beats generation, Low End Theory is the place, really. It's in a club in Lincoln Heights, which is the ghetto, really. And it's an old bar from the Prohibition period. And I suppose if Tom York's in town, that's the kind of, you know, that's the spot that he's always going to play. But the atmosphere in that place is absolutely wild. It goes down every week on a Wednesday. And I guess every single time I cross the threshold of Low End Theory, I know that I'm going to hear music in that club, the like of which I've never heard before in my life. So it's one of the reasons that I love it, you know. But I guess that's the great hub for Flying Lotus and all of that generation of artists that kind of came through Brain Feeder. They all love to play in that place, you know.
Yeah. And not crushed by the weight of expectation like DMZ. Like, sometimes that is too much of a burden to carry, but if you can just have Tom York roll through and it not be a thing, it's pretty cool.
Yeah, absolutely.
I want to track back to what you said about the dancers and their response to music. This kind of feeds into the proms that you put on. Mm. So for those of you that don't know, maybe outside the country, BBC do an annual thing called the Proms, which is I think it's the world's largest, longest classical annual broadcast. I don't know quite how you'd sum it up.
Yeah, I suppose it's a great pinnacle for classical music, really. It's a series that's renowned the world over, and so they bring in orchestras, like the finest orchestras, the finest classical music from across the planet for the best part of 3 months, actually. Mm-hmm. It's a season that happens at the Royal Albert Hall in London, which is a beautiful venue. It's a place that Queen Victoria built as a great testimony to her love for her husband who died, Albert. And, it's king of the hill in yeah. classical music terms. It's probably as simple as that, really. Yeah.
And you brought Nils Frahm and A Winged Victory for the Sullen to the Royal Albert Hall in what I can only guess was in gestation for the best part of a year or something like that.
So the story goes like this, I guess. I went to see Nils at the Royal Northern College of Music in September of last year, so 11 months ago, and spoke to him about the idea of creating a prom with A Winged Victory for the Sullen. And I don't know, I guess both of us thought we could achieve something really extraordinary in that space. We could really change things. And I don't know, at the time it felt like a very kind of elusive dream. And I wasn't certain whether or not I could actually make it stick. But anyway, Radio 3 eventually decided that they were going to commission it as the Six Music Prom. And we spent, obviously, the best part of a year bringing together these two very, very different worlds. You know, a world that is based in 120 years of tradition with artists that I feel are our new generation. You know, artists who have quite clearly got classical roots but are drawing in all kinds of other influences, texturally, electronic influences, and then just reimagining all of this in such a beautiful way. And I guess, I mean, I've been playing Nils' music on the radio show for 2.5 years, and I've, as you probably know, I've championed him really passionately. And I had seen that enormous degree of passion that I had for his music mirrored back by a vast global audience, people responding in exactly the same way as I did, just feeling like here is a musician who has a kind of magic the like of which you only find once every 10 years. And here is also, you know, a musician doing something entirely different. You know, he has a set of ideas that are very old, which are important to him, that come from his classical roots, but he is building into that absolutely cutting edge technology, his passion for all kinds of different textures of contemporary music. This is a man building his own instruments, you know, and he's a man who is crossing every conceivable boundary. So you would find him at Sydney Opera House, you would also find him at Latitude Festival, you'd find him at Berghain in Berlin, you know, and he's taking this extraordinary sound that he creates across every conceivable boundary, really. So I thought, why not? We can bring that to the Royal Albert Hall. And I think with Winged, similarly, I discovered their music about a year later and was absolutely captivated by the textures of their sound. I just thought it was exquisitely beautiful. I would also probably say that they are really primary in terms of next generation artists who are involved with that kind of classical sound. And I love the idea of sort of bringing a distillation of what both of them do onto that stage together, and then for them to be able to enmesh the two sets in the centre, which I thought would be really unique. Even if you'd seen a Nils gig or a Winged gig, you would have never have seen a kind of collaborative element between them.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Which I thought was really nice when Nils kind of gingerly strode the stage. And people went wild, as if it was a major rock star appearing with, I don't know, I'm not even going to start naming names because it's on a bit old hat, but it was really people, I mean, I said this before we started recording, but almost slam dancing to Nils at the end of the show. People were really losing it.
Yeah.
And this is to a man tapping away on two pianos whose music implies a solitude.
Yeah.
And people resonate with that so deeply that it flips on its head and becomes almost like a wild, ecstatic experience. It's a nice paradox.
It was really interesting, actually, because the collaboration became a real thing for both of them, because Winged are very traditional. They like to write and rehearse everything. Nils is much more freeform. He's like, no, we can improvise, you know, it's going to be fine. So in the end, what happened, Dustin from Winged wrote an entire matrix of different parts, the idea being that any musician on that stage at that time could play any part that they decided to play, but it would all mesh together. How on earth, technically, that's even possible, I don't know, but it gave Nils entire freedom to do whatever he wanted, but within the framework that Dustin had created. Yeah. So it still felt that he you know, he had that degree of choice, so he could, however he felt in a moment, he could respond with one of the parts. But I remember a couple of weeks before we were due to stage the prom, London Underground announced that they were striking.
Yeah.
And I was literally like, oh God. And obviously I support everybody's right to strike, I'll just make that perfectly clear, I really do. But I know, having lived in London for many, many years myself, how much a strike will paralyse the city and make it really, really difficult for people to move about, and also very expensive if people need to take taxis. So in spite of the fact that it was the first of all of the late night proms to sell out, we sold 5,000 tickets in 5 days for that prom, which was mind-blowing really. I had a huge anxiety for my audience because I thought, oh God, are they going to be able to get there, you know? But on the day, it blew me away, literally. People were tweeting me all day saying, I'm walking 20 miles, you know? I'm coming on crutches, whatever it may be. But it wasn't until I literally stepped out onto the edge of the stage to introduce the prom live on television that I knew that that room was full and there wasn't a single empty seat in the house. And everybody had got there, come hell or high water, they made it, you know. But I had the most extraordinary set of messages as well from people that I know about who came in from 5 international destinations just to see that prom. So, you know.
Yeah, I mean, the bus rank outside was pretty swollen, but people weren't griping, so I guess you got the balance just about right.
Did you not have the boiler room jetpack?
Again, if we can sort that out at any point, that'll be really handy, but no, we're still pretty basic. We're still my bus pack.
I think in the aftermath, it felt like we had done everything that we dreamed might be possible that night, that we'd literally turned a page in history and we'd opened a new chapter. And it was a similar kind of a feeling in the aftermath of Sunn O in 2007. You just think, everything changes tonight, you know. And that's a wonderful thing. It probably only happens once in a decade that you get that kind of platform and you have that incredible momentum that you feel building behind artists, which I felt the same about the dubstep artists at the point at which we took them to Sunn O. They were ready. It was a couple of years in, as it was with Nils and Wind. It was a couple of years in and I knew that the momentum was there. And I knew creatively they were ready for that stage and they could step up and they could absolutely blow people's minds, which is what they did. But the response in the aftermath too has been, I don't know, just wild. People are watching the footage over and over and over and over again on the iPlayer. And
which I should mention, by the way, if you're watching this before early September, you can access that on the iPlayer because it's still within the 30-day period.
Yeah,
obviously.
And you know, people are kind of calling for DVD releases and asking whether or not it could be screened on television, you know, again on maybe on 4 or something like that. And I don't know what the answer to any of that is, but it was probably one of my greatest nights on earth, as was Sunn O in 2007. They were probably my 2 greatest nights on earth. And there's enormous parallels between the two of them, even in terms of music and space, and what we were speaking about earlier, the idea that you find not only this incredible sense of excitement, as you say, being part of, I think you felt it in the room that night, didn't you, that amazing, that it was electric, the atmosphere, that sense of anticipation and that sense of understanding that you were at a really special moment in history, but also that sense of space and that sense of peace within the music too, you know. So I don't know, the more I think about it, the more parallels I find. It's really interesting.
I'm going to try and really ham-fistedly combine what you've been talking about Sunn O and what you've been talking about the proms, talking about application of space, an electric atmosphere, what people really tap into at heart, and we're going to flip from white to black and talk about Sunn. I think now's probably the best chance for you to pop on the Sunn track. For those that don't know, I'm assuming some do, see Sunn's on the brain already. Sunn are massive, monolithic, thick, sludgy doom metal. And you're sitting here next to me having seen them last night and survived and lived to tell the tale. And they're an interesting one. I don't think a lot of people would assume that they're a band that you like and that you champion. It kind of tracks back to your early history in terms of punk and metal and rock. But yeah, how was it?
Oh, I think that they have reassembled every atom in my body, maybe at a subatomic level actually. Every cell in my body feels like it's in a different place this morning. But it's interesting, I sent Stephen a message to say, in real terms, how loud are you? Am I going to need a crash helmet at this gig, you know? And he said to me, the frequencies are not damaging, but the sound is immense. And it's unlike anything that I've ever experienced, really, at that level. And what was interesting about that was that they were in a very, very different environment. Obviously, they're playing David Byrne's Meltdown Festival, so they're at the Royal Festival Hall in a seated venue, and you have a ticket for a very specific seat, which means you are trapped in that space to a degree. But you have to surrender to it. I mean, it's a sound that will completely overwhelm you. And again, that's a wonderful thing, I think, you know. In a world that's so ordered and so carefully marshalled all the time, so moderated, so mannered, it feels like a trapdoor to me. It's something that I'm always looking for, like a trapdoor to drop out into a different space where you have a sensory experience that's completely overwhelming. And I have to confess, I did sit there with earplugs in and my Sennheiser headphones over the top because it was so loud. And I only got halfway in because I thought, I love you, but I'm not going to go deaf for you, you know. So,
did you catch Purpa beforehand?
Yeah.
Tibetan throat thing.
Wow.
Or rather, Russians. I'm not sure if that's the fashion.
Yeah.
That's so pretty out there as
they
well.
They sit cross-legged on the ground with these amazing headpieces on. Uh-huh. They're like very tall pointed hats with veils over the front, and they have pieces of parchment on the ground, and they turn the pages of parchment as they are singing, and they burn incense, and the guy who leads them also has a bowl that he uses as a percussion instrument. But that's intense. It will almost put you into a trance-like state, even in a venue that's very formal, like the Royal Festival Hall is. It was pure escapism for me, and I love that. I think, to a degree, we're in an age where, how do I express this properly? We're in an age where we understand every detail, every component part of every performance that we ever see before we even go to it, in many cases.
Yeah.
Because there's so much information available, and which in many ways is also a good thing, but the paradox is that I suppose nothing really catches you unawares and surprises you anymore, because you already know how your experience is going to play out.
Yeah, we can joke about how loud the band are going to be and whether my ears would have been wrecked and you sitting and being trapped by smoke without me having to actually go and experience the concert.
Mm. But
which is both good and, I suppose, a little shortfall, because nothing can really spring a surprise on you.
Yeah, but you go into a space like that. Oh, it's funny, I saw some tweets actually during the sound check. Stephen had said they'd shorted out an entire main power circuit at the Royal Festival Hall, and there was lighting just dropping off the ceiling, because the frequencies are so intense. But no matter what you read, no matter what you see online, no matter how many YouTube clips you watch, it won't prepare you for the intensity of something like that, a performance by Sunn. And I just, I feel those types of things are really, really valuable to us as a culture. We don't want to experience everything secondhand online, and then actually to be present in a room and nothing really particularly beyond that experience happens. I think it's really important to be able to go into physical spaces and have those degrees of extremes that Sunn offer, you know, that are completely overwhelming. I mean, the whole of the rest of the world could have literally fallen apart around my seat and I wouldn't have even have noticed. You know, it could have all fell away underneath me. the whole of Earth could have been consumed by a black hole, and I wouldn't have noticed, honestly. So, but I don't know. It's that kind of trapdoor is something that I'm always seeking, you know. And I guess to a degree, it correlates with a kind of freedom that I'm always seeking.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a freedom in my own expression as well as the expression of artists that I love. You know, it's the only way that I can quantify it, really. It's kind of hard to talk about. It's hard to identify. But I love that when you feel that you've been utterly and completely consumed and overwhelmed by an artist. It's just, yeah, it's a wonderful state to be in the aftermath.
Are you trying to use the word consumed repeatedly? Because the next track is called Consumed.
Haxan Cloak.
I have actually written in my notes, like a trapdoor opening, and you mentioned Sunn as a trapdoor twice. This all segued very nicely.
Yeah.
The Haxan Cloak is by no means a mainstream artist. His music's not permutable to a mainstream audience. You've described it previously as like marginal music, and yet again, just as with the case of early dubstep and just as the case of the kind of neoclassical movement, it's tapping into a far wider audience now. I think it's doing like Foles remixes, and obviously had a big hand alongside Arca and Rabbit in the current stage of Bjork's career.
Absolutely.
And yet it is gigantic dynamic shifts at extreme volume, but he's playing big festival stages. It's a really interesting one to me.
Yeah, it's not marginal. This is, you know, this is really interesting. This term is used all the time. These artists are marginal, and you think, well, yeah, but on whose terms? You know, it's not marginal music at all. I think he's scoring for True Detective in America now too. I just saw some trailers. Yeah, and I'm thrilled for him, and I think he'll probably do a lot of work in cinema, I would imagine too.
But one thing that I think we should come to is your history.
Yeah.
Not a lot of people, I guess, know quite the extent of what you did before you came to be a major broadcaster. I personally did a double take when you've written down the story of meeting Bowie, who we're listening now to, obviously. I think you've got some great yarns to spin, if you want to go for it.
Yeah, where do you want to start? I think we should talk about, I suppose, childhood, really, because that's where Bowie came from. Subterraneans, we're listening to now from his album Low, was one of the first two albums that I ever bought, the other one being Thin Lizzy, Live and Dangerous. But I mean, music was a very exotic commodity when I was little. There was a toy shop in the village that I lived in called Mia's Toys, and if you wanted to buy any music, any singles or albums, you would go to Mia's Toy Shop and you would lay down your money, order the record you wanted, and you have to wait 9 weeks for it to arrive at the shop. But I lived in a house where my dad had banned all music.
Right.
So every time he would find my little sock drawer full of Sex Pistols singles, he'd smash them all to pieces. And this album got smashed as well, actually. And the only thing that he never found was a tiny little transistor radio that I had, which was about as big as a can of tuna. And on this radio, I used to, in the dead of night, under my blankets, I used to scroll across the dial and look for John Peel's show, which I had happened upon by a complete freak of accident. And Peel seemed to stand at the gateway to a kind of alternate universe for me. And it was a universe that felt so far away, you know, when I was a kid. But I thought, I want to find this place. I want to go and live in this place where John Peel lives with this, all this amazing music, you know.
Worked out all right.
Yeah. So when I was little, I never had any dreams of being a broadcaster at all. It just seemed entirely unattainable. I didn't even think about it. But I used to simultaneously, I bought a music paper called Sounds, which is very much like NME used to be, actually. It's
sure.
Just a weekly music paper. And my dream was to have a job writing for Sounds. I thought that's what I want to do. And I don't know, it never occurred to me to do anything quite so simple as just send in a review to the editor of Sounds. I thought, God, what would this guy want to see? What can I show him that, you know, that will be meaningful to him? And so I thought, well, I must have had to have worked for a band. Surely that's got to be a starting point. So to cut an amazingly long story short, every 6 months or so, in our village in Garstang, there was an old school working men's club and they used to book a live band. And I remember one day on the chalkboard, a notice went up, it said Heretic from London. And I thought, this is it. This is my trapdoor out of this place. You know, I'm going to get a job with this band. And so I went to the gig that night and I talked to them and I said, what is it that you need? I'll do anything to, you know, to work for you. And they said, well, we need a backdrop. So I said, I can paint a backdrop for you. A backdrop is something that bands used to have back in the day. It's like a giant piece of fabric with their logo painted on it. So I went up to the local town, to Preston, and I bought reams and reams of material that they'd had left over from the war, which was blackout curtain material, and duly painted Heretic's logo on it and bundled it up into a little rucksack, took it to London, and never went home. And unbeknown to me, when I arrived, this band actually lived on a bus in a car park. And the bus was like some kind of broken down old vehicle out of a Mike Leigh movie or something like that. We used to call it the Blue Goose Hotel. And I lived on this bus with the band for best part of a year, you know. And that was the first foot on the causeway, you know. And I remember kind of after about a year or so, I was doing some extra jobs so that I could write my own fanzine, which I did a couple of issues of this fanzine, and I sent it off to the editor of Sounds with, I think, the craziest CV he's probably ever seen in his life, detailing all my responsibilities, you know, to the band. So I said, you know, I paint their backdrops, I design their record sleeves, I'm the bus mechanic, I'm the lighting engineer when we go on tour, all this stuff. And he invited me in to go and see him, and I remember sitting down in front of him. I was 19 years old. His name was Eric Fuller, and he said, you live on a bus? What on earth do you think you're doing? He's like, why didn't you just do something as simple as sending in a review to me? You know, it never would have occurred to me at all, you know, being a kid from a village in the north, you know, in the late 70s, early 80s, you know, 1,000 people lived there. I'd got no idea how to make any kind of moves into the music industry. I just didn't have a clue, so I followed my nose and that's what happened.
I mean, obviously it worked out, but you took it to its logical extreme and then some, when it, the easiest route A would have been, I guess, it would have done the trick. But I suppose you proved yourself in oodles, living on the bus with a band called Heretic.
It's quite
probably
a challenge.
Gave you a pretty strong education, what you need to get by.
Yeah.
Whereas writing a review would have been one of many.
Yeah, I mean, in those days as well.
It's a ridiculous story. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, you can. I mean, the sanitation was a real challenge. Let me tell
you. Yeah, I can imagine.
There was one public toilet up the road, and I remember sort of taking a wash bag in the depths of January, you know, a sponge bag, into this freezing cold public toilet, thinking, oh, this is actually quite a challenge. It was funny. I mean, we had to save up all the money that we earned. We all worked these really terrible day jobs. So a couple of the band were grave diggers. A couple of them worked in a dog dish factory where they stuck the stickers on the bottom of the dishes as the dishes went past. Me and the singer worked in a sweet factory where they used to bring these giant oil drums full of Maltesers, and we would pick out anything that could be repackaged as a first, in inverted commas. They're all seconds, apparently. And there was a chippy on the corner of the car park, and we literally used to live on one bag of chips a day and save all the rest of our money to fix this kind of broken down old bus and all the equipment that we had. I mean, we had backline and lights and everything that you could wish for, but it was all in a relatively challenging state of disrepair, so it needed a lot of work all the time. And then we literally would go to a phone box, look in the back of Sounds where all the venues were listed, and when we had enough money saved up, we would book a tour in a phone box, you know, and then off we'd go on the road and all over the UK and play these various different gigs. And as far as I was concerned, I was living the dream, you know. It was freezing cold. Sleeping as well was really, it was quite, you had to sleep in all your clothes with as many pieces of fabric or, I don't know, cardboard boxes, whatever you could find to lay over the top of yourself, because it was so bitterly cold in the winter months on that bus. But still, I couldn't conceive of another way to do it, you know. There wasn't another pathway at all, you know. And I don't know, in many ways it makes you really strong, because you just, I was still, a bit like Kendrick when he reverts to his backflips on the bed, I'll kind of think, well, I lived on a bus, you know, I can do anything. I lived on a bus for a year. How bad can anything possibly be, you know?
Something that's kind of come up in my mind that I hadn't thought about beforehand, but when you fed back living on that bus back to Kendrick, it kind of made me realise that I'm guessing you take a lot of stock in authenticity and honesty and loyal to the soil, let's say, and a purity, because a lot of what you're describing of people coming from situations where they're kind of swimming upstream, let's say, against challenges and succeeding. Plus this one is Skepta, one of the songs you put down to play. It was kind of a middle period where grime has fallen somewhat out of favour before it's had its recent resurgence. But obviously those two are both artists, Skepta especially, in light of the year that he's just had, of people who wouldn't say came from absolute nothing, but fought their way upstream and made immense success in what they do. And that's kind of the thing that ties a lot of your, I guess, musical taste together and who you really take heart in. I'd like to hear any stories you have about Skepta back in the days, yeah, I suppose the early days, back in the mid-2000s, before he kind of had some resurgence. And I don't know if you've caught up with him recently and spoken to him since he's hit this acceleration back into the mainstream.
I just have these amazing memories of Ford back in the day, around about 2005, and Skepta, Jamie, all of that crew just absolutely lighting up that booth. It was wild. And I feel that the Adenuga brothers have worked really, really hard, and they deserve every shred of success that they're getting at the moment. I'm really, really elated to see them do it on their own terms as well. And also to see the Americans turn their head, you know, Kanye, Drake, really, really big stars looking towards Britain to see what it is that our MCs are doing. And, you know, I feel that those voices are really authentic. And it's interesting, isn't it, as you say. I think the audiences have changed completely. And I think grime is attracting a whole new generation of much, much younger people who wouldn't even remember it from 10 years ago at all. They're just engaging with it at this point, you know. It's really, really exciting to see Rico on the run that he is at the moment, you know. It's really exciting to anticipate what Trim might do next.
Yeah.
And, you know, also, Trim's been writing films too with a kid called Luke Carlisle.
I didn't know that, that's very cool.
Yeah, so check it out. It's called He Works the Long Nights. They've done a short together. It's 7 minutes long. It's a Vimeo staff pick, and it's an exquisite piece of work. Rico's got a new radio show, which I absolutely love, Verbal Volley on NTS.
Yeah.
Raw grime and real talk about football. I heard him throw the first one down a couple of weeks ago, and I just thought it was the most exciting thing I'd heard in the radio in as long as I can remember. And There's lots of new talent coming through as well. I really, really rate Roxbo. He's 22 years old, he's from Croydon. Been writing since his teens, and he's just got such a degree of passion and commitment. Mm-hmm. I've got an eye on him at the moment. And I think Manchester's moving in incredible ways as well. I mean, the most recent tune from Levels is just completely mind-blowing.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's great.
Level 9, yeah, it's just wild. All those MCs I've got so much respect for. You know,
there's a lot of cheek in the... I mean, it's serious, like, great grime music, but some of the lines are very cheeky in the way that early Boy Better Know was kind of done with a wink and a nudge and a bit of, like, comedy capers in amongst what's pretty hard music.
Yeah.
I think there's a line on Level song, something like Hit the Gutter Like Razor Light, which I kind of smirked quite heavily at the first time I heard, just like hearing Jamie as a kid and being like, yeah, he's pretty funny guy.
Yeah. bitch, I'll switch the Haxan Cloak lens. One to the eyeball, one to the nose. I don't really care about your postcode. Set yourself down to the no rose. 2 minutes in my bedroom, no clothes. Girls everywhere, girls in the club. Looking at me trying to make a black and black.
It's funny you mentioned as well the Skepta crossing over to the States and the fact that there's a new breed of young MCs coming through. There's a fantastic picture of Skepta and Novelist on stage at MoMA PS1. Skepta wearing all white with his shirt half open, just looking like the embodiment of power, and Novelist behind him looking just geeked to be on the stage with him. And there doesn't seem to be a bridge between, or rather there doesn't seem to be a barrier between Skepta and, let's say, Novelist and Stormzy, some of the bigger names of the new generation. There isn't a pretext of trying to keep people down. It feels that this is a second win that grime's having, both at an instrumental level and for vocalists. And it feels like this community that maybe wasn't so there in the early days, when there's a lot of postcode wars, a lot of stuff that threatened to tear grime apart after a few years, now maybe a little bit more moderated and sanitised, but everyone's pulling in the same direction, it seems. It's pretty exciting.
Yeah, I think they're really, really exciting times. And I would agree, I think the postcode wars were very destructive. I think it's interesting as well, there was a definite separation to a degree between grime and dubstep, because dubstep didn't want any of that kind of violence to permeate what it was that they were doing, especially when they were trying to establish, you know. But it feels just like such an incredible flashpoint for this scene now. And again, it's something that's been building over years and years and years. And it's just, I don't know, it feels like an incendiary moment, really, for want of a better expression, really. But you know, maybe incendiary is the right word, you know. And for me, as a great lover of that culture, I could not be more elated to see these men have their moment. You know, it's a wonderful thing. And I'm just waiting to see what happens next. I think Skepta has really opened the gates, and he has a huge degree of love and respect for me for that. He's literally opened the gates to a brand new audience, and an international audience too, that have never really come across grime before. And it'll be really interesting to see what comes in his wake, definitely. I haven't seen him for a while. I'd love to see him, but yeah, I haven't seen him for a bit, face to face. I never really take holidays. The only holiday that I had earlier on this year was to go to an ice music festival in Norway and experience music that is made on instruments that are built out of ice.
Like every part is made of
ice? Yeah, absolutely. They harvest the ice from giant frozen lakes in the north of Norway, and it comes in 2-ton blocks. And then they bring in an American, his name is Bill, and he's fantastic. And he uses chisels that are made in Japan by a guy who makes samurai swords. So you can imagine, he needs some pretty sharp chisels for the ice. And he's a master craftsman and makes all kinds of different instruments out of ice. And there's a beautiful amphitheatre made in the village of Yalo in Norway, all made out of snow. And it's tiny, maybe 200 people attend. The sets are maybe half an hour long, because that's as much as the musicians can take, because it's like minus 17 degrees or something, it's crazy. But it is some of the most magical music I've ever heard in a lifetime. And they fly in musicians of great, great caliber to play the various different instruments that they've made out of ice. So you've got virtuoso musicians playing these ice instruments. And Arve Heinrichsen is one of the main horn players, and oh my god, when you hear him play these ice horns, and he has a technique where he can get them to ricochet off the mountain sides. It's some of the most primal and beautiful music I've ever heard in a lifetime. It's just extraordinary. But that's kind of what, you know, if I go on holiday, that's what I do. I'll go and try to seek something out that's totally extraordinary. But this is my next weekend off, is to go and see Kumasi Washington.
Yeah.
Play in London. And
I was wondering how you're going to segue from the ice music into there.
I just thought I have to tell you about ice music.
No, I've but, captivated where that one was, right.
But yeah, Kumasi is he picked up a saxophone at the age of 13, his father's instrument, and I think just never put it down again. And he's introducing jazz to a whole new generation of people,
yeah,
I think.
Absolutely.
You know, and again, I play his music on the radio and watch this phenomenal global response. And it's just wild to see him at like number one on the iTunes jazz chart, and I don't know, number one across the universe pretty much. It's brilliant. And my friends who've seen him live in LA say that he plays with a 30-piece band and it's like nothing on earth, you know.
That's good. I'd be wary that, especially when he tours nationally, he might have to hem that in, but it's not as if he's going to be doing 30-day tours. He picks and chooses to make sure the experience is proper.
Yeah.
Like for an album that took, I think, something like 4.5 years to make, and obviously so many virtuoso musicians on it, you want to get the full experience.
Yeah, oh, it's great. And I think, I mean, he played on Kendrick's album,
yeah,
as did Thundercat, and he played on Flying Lotus' album.
Yeah.
And I think Lotus was very instrumental in the cohesion of his ideas as well, and actually delivering an album, which is a triple album, you know, it's a huge piece of work.
Huge, broad array of sounds as well. Some sound like big band recording from the 30s, and some very hard left jazz. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, oh, it's amazing. But I don't know, it's a... Again, I suppose in many ways, like Peel, I'm always looking for that element of magic in something. And I think we're in a, probably culturally, we're in a situation where you're always going to hear influences. You know, you're always going to hear where a sound originated from and where influences are being absorbed, but it's the way in which those are interpreted. And I feel, I mean, clearly Kamasi's a jazz musician, but I think his interpretation of jazz is very different. And I just wanna see him play, man. You know, he's gonna set my heart on fire. I know it. So
it's incredible to me, because beyond sounds that hadn't previously really existed in dubstep, the things you're talking about with extreme passion and vigor are elements of classical and jazz, which for most people my age or my generation are considered perhaps old hat and stale. And yet you're taking artists into your heart that are really utilising the forms in different ways, and that is kind of what's exciting. I didn't think many people would have sat around 4 or 5 years ago and been like, neoclassical and experimental jazz are going to be at the forefront of a young generation. Yet here we are. Like, it's a really interesting thing, in the way that Kendrick, as we said earlier, has synergised these sounds and made it applicable for like a platinum disc that is filling every lowrider car across the states, and it's weird bebop and sprawling jazz as his bed. It's a pretty awesome thing.
Yeah. I think as well, we're sort of, I don't know, I'm in a position where my audience range from toddlers practically now, all the way up until people who are 90 years old, and I love that. I love the fact that when I was at the prom, I was sitting in this little box that Radio 3 had because I had to wrap up their shows for them, and next to me was this very beautiful woman who'd got a little boy with her who must have been, I don't know, 7 years old, absolute tops, and I saw him right on the edge of his seat. She went to me, and he was right on the edge of his seat, just completely captivated by Nils. And I thought, what a beautiful moment to see this seven-year-old boy enchanted in the same way that I am by the music of Nils. And so is my mother's best friend, who's touching 90, you know, who always wants all of his new CDs. I have to send them across, you know. And I think, for me, it's universal, isn't it? And it's about the way that it touches you, and I don't know, it does something to your soul, doesn't it? And I love that I'm no longer in a situation where I need to worry about a demographic. It doesn't even remotely concern me at all. It's about, I don't know, where is the next magic coming from? How is that going to fly into my space, and how will I interpret that? And how will that kind of coalesce into a broadcast or a live event that I can share with other people, really, you know?
I had a conversation with my dad quite recently about nothing being shocking anymore, and he was saying, and he wasn't really using it as negative, but testing me, saying, you know, I went through various eras where boundaries were demolished, that punk was shocking, people swearing on TV, and then hip-hop was shocking, and this and that. your generation isn't really creating anything that is shocking people, therefore does it have less merit? And I said to him, well, yeah, but once those barriers are deconstructed, the walls don't exist anymore, someone going on TV and swearing isn't going to shock anyone now. And I think the value in contemporary music is that the landscape is completely flattened, there are the barriers to entry, either for people consuming or making music, and people are shaping into new forms in a way that hadn't really been done before. And that demographic shift that you said, you don't really need to be keeping an eye on a certain market anymore. Obviously, you're not going to have 90-year-olds in Jericho, but broadly speaking, a lot of stuff is applicable across the board, and that means that more people have access and more people have the impetus to recreate it. And I think it's a pretty exciting time just because there isn't one overarching movement everyone's annoyed to. Yeah. Kind of what your show reflects for me, I suppose a lot of listeners, that it touches all parts of the map and is stronger for it.
Yeah, I'm just listening to this. I knew I'd be distracted if we played the music. There's a point at which the sax is just shrieking and the notes are just literally breaking. They're almost, he's tearing them apart because he's peaking in terms of what he can actually do with that instrument, you know. And I don't know, I love that. Absolutely love it. I love that kind of degree of abandon, again that sort of sense of freedom that Kamasi has in his playing as well, that he'll tip it right to the very edge of a precipice, you know, and that's, I think it's joyful for in any context to hear that, you know, that kind of that freedom, that's always what I'm looking for, you know, in a word.
Yeah. I mean we could sit here and chat for hours and hours and hours. It's been a pleasure. There is one more thing that I personally want to play.
Go on.
It is... So I think, and I may have my dates wrong, but I think today is 7 years since I first heard one of your shows.
Wow.
It was the Generation Bass show, which was late August in 2008, something like that.
Wow.
And the track that Starkey closed on in his little mini mix was this, Spacewalk. and I figured that I'd quite like to play it. Yeah, I don't know, partly for sentimental reasons, but also because it's a pretty great track and contains a lot of the melodic, floaty, ambient sounds that is also found in new instrumental grime now.
Yeah, that was really interesting, Generation Bass. I mean, the idea was that I would take the original artist who played the seminal Dubstep War show and asked them to choose the next man. So they all got to choose an artist to play. And we did it at the BBC's Maidenvale Studios, and it was, yeah, we did it live. It was wild. It was incredible.
Like shaking the walls and stuff.
Yeah. But it was interesting actually, I was out with Loefah very recently. We went to one of Malo's dances and we were hanging out together. And one of his fans, a young girl, came over to him and started talking to him about Mud. And and he said, oh, I wrote Mud for Mary Anne. And that's kind of not really strictly true, although it really touched my heart when he said it. He wrote it for Dubstep Wars. And I remember on the night when he turned up at Radio 1 Studios, he was exhausted. And I said, are you okay? And he was like, he said, I've been up for 48 hours straight. And at that time, he and Pokes were working at a place in London where black taxis used to come in. And on the side, have you ever seen those very big advertisements that you'll sometimes see on the side of black taxis?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They all need to be stuck on. So he and Pokes were in this freezing cold garage in the middle of January, up to their necks in glue, sticking these adverts on the side of black cabs. And he said, I was doing that all day, and then he said I had to stay awake two nights, all the way through the night, to finish Mud for Dubstep Wars, you know. But I remember when I heard that tune drop, I thought it was the greatest piece of music I'd ever heard in my life, you know, literally at that point in time. Same sort of response as when I heard Nils Fram say it's for the very first time. I would put that right up there too with one of the greatest pieces of music I've ever heard in that moment, you know, when you hear it for the first time.
I hope you keep having those kind of greatest moments on and on and on.
Yeah.
And on.
That's the great thing though, isn't it, about greatest moments, that you can, there's always another, you know. And hopefully I'll have another greatest night on earth. I don't know when that'll be. Maybe in another decade, it's hard to say, but...
That's, I suppose, the joy of music. You never know what it's going to spring up on you.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah. There's always... there's always a new pathway opening every day, and you know, it's what makes my job so thrilling. I've got no idea where the next Loefah or Nils Fram is going to come from, and what form they may take. They certainly won't be in that kind of shape either. It'll be something entirely different and new. So yeah, I'm excited always to see what's next. Bring it on.
Awesome. That's a nice way to wrap up. Thank you so, so, so much.
Absolute pleasure.
Absolute pleasure. Cheers. Cool. Please.
Yay.